Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 17. Rules for holy living. Paul writes, "Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but now you must rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge and the image of its creator. For here there is no Greek or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian or Scythian, or slave or free, for Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, whether in word or in deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. I am not sure how often we as Methodists or United Methodists know how extensive our Wesleyan family really is. Now, there are some things that we hold in common. We believe in three stages of grace, that God's prevenient grace — prevenio means coming before — that God's prevenient grace comes before we even respond to God and woos us to Christ and allows us the freedom to be able to respond to God's call in Christ Jesus. And that leads us to justifying grace, where we are made right in our relationship to God through what Jesus did on the cross. But that leads to the most distinctive Wesleyan doctrine, which is sanctifying grace, that God does not save us through Jesus Christ to leave us the way God found us, but to transform us for the transformation of the world. Sanctifying grace, indeed, is our most distinctive doctrine. It's important to know that God's prevenient grace woos us. It's even more important to know that we've been born again, regenerated, saved, justified in a relationship with God, which is relative change, but sanctifying grace equals real change. At least we hope so. At least we hope so. And so in the Wesleyan family, there are those who focus on sanctifying grace to lesser and greater degrees. And it seems that there were those in the 1880s, 1890s, some years before, some years after, who focused more on sanctification than we Methodists did. And so, I don't know if you knew or not, but the Salvation Army, the Pentecostal Holiness Church, the Church of God, Cleveland, Tennessee, the Assemblies of God, the Nazarene Church, all of those denominations came out of the Methodist Church. They focused on sanctification more than we did. You see, what happened is that we used to meet together on Sunday nights and during midweek services. Baptists did not invent Sunday night services or midweek services. Methodists did. We saw those as an opportune time for us to come together and have fellowship. It was expected that good Methodists would go to their Church of England churches on Sunday mornings in England when John Wesley founded the Methodist Church. And then on Sunday night, they would come together and would fellowship, would have a praise service, would have exhortation, and would have a time of witness. And then during the midweek, a group of around 12 would meet together in a class meeting, men with men, women with women, children with children, youth with youth, and a class leader would ask, "How goes it with your soul?" And what they really meant was, "I want you to confess what sins you've committed in thought, word, or deed since we last met together." So in about 1835, we got tired of sharing all of that interesting minutia and self-revelation. And there were those who were of us who thought we need to recapture that sense of accountability and that sense of holiness. And so we have the Salvation Army, the Assemblies of God, the Nazarene Church, the Church of God, Cleveland, Tennessee, the Pentecostal Holiness Church, etc., etc., etc. But holiness has always been part and parcel of what we are about as Methodists. It means that we ourselves expect to be changed and that we want to change the world. We believe that God loves us so much that He doesn't want us to leave us the way God found us. But He also doesn't want the world to stay the same. He wants everything to get better out of love and out of compassion and out of discipline. Some of you studied some years ago here at St. John's, Reverend Nancy was a part of this, a book by Bishop Reuben Job called Three Simple Rules. And you might remember the book, Three Simple Rules. And it said, first of all, the rule is do no harm. Second, do good. And third, stay in love with God. A simple little book entitled Three Simple Rules. But Reuben Job left out much of what is written in our book of guidance. No, it's not called a book of suggestions. It's not called a book of law. It's called a book of discipline of the United Methodist Church, which underscores that we as Methodists believe in discipline. We believe in holiness. We even entitle our book of order that governs everything about our denomination as a book of discipline. Now, there may be those from the Western jurisdiction to South Carolina that may disagree with what it says, but it is our common book of order, and it's about discipline. Because God doesn't save us through Jesus Christ to leave us the way God found us, but to transform us and to transform the world. And so it has in there these three simple rules unpacked in a way that make them a little more than simple. First, by doing no harm. Now, Reuben Job doesn't spell out what doing no harm means, but John Wesley did. He says, by avoiding evil of every kind, especially that which is most generally practiced, such as the taking of the name of God in vain, the profaning the day of the Lord, either by doing ordinary work therein or by buying or selling, oh my word, drunkenness, buying or selling spirituous liquors or drinking them unless in cases of extreme necessity. Slaveholding, buying or selling slaves, fighting, quarreling, brawling, going to law against brothers or sisters in Christ, the using of many words in buying or selling. Interesting. The buying or selling goods that have not had their taxes paid. Oh, I don't know about tax-free holidays. The giving of or taking of things with unlawful high interest. Oh, this is a favorite. Uncharitable or unprofitable conversation, particularly speaking of government officials or of preachers. Doing to others as we would not they should do unto us. Doing what we know is not for the glory of God, such as the putting on of gold and costly apparel, the taking such diversions as cannot be used in the name of the Lord Jesus, the singing of those songs, the reading those books which do not tend to the knowledge or love of God. And it just goes on and on. And then secondly, it says by doing good, and it talks about doing merciful works and all this stuff. But then it gets into that last thing of these not so simple rules, staying in love with God. He calls them ordinances of God. John Wesley calls them that. And he lists these things, the public worship of God. You know, it's interesting, in the summer, attendance is up and down. Up in the mountains or down at the beach. It says the public worship of God, not on the boat, on the lake, but public worship of God. Well, I mean, yeah. Ministry of the word, whether read or expounded. The Lord's Supper, family and private prayer. Searching the scriptures, not just glancing at it, but searching the scriptures. Fasting or abstinence. And then he goes on to say, if someone does not keep these three not so simple rules, to do no harm, to do good, and to stay in love with God with these specific ways, if someone does not continue to do these things, follow these rules, it says, we will admonish him of the error of his ways, we will bear with him for a season. But then if he repent not, he hath no more place among us. We have delivered our own souls. I'm just saying, those are not so simple rules. But they are the rules of holiness. And Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 17 are all about rules for holy living. How we might draw closer to God so that God might draw closer to us. Now, Paul, in Colossians chapter 1, uses a Greco-Roman literary device. He mentions three lists of five, which really means that the list is not exhaustive, but those three lists mean such as these things. And this is what he says, that first of all, in the first two sets of five, there are things that we should put to death or we should take off, as if in clothing. And first of all, he says sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which are mostly inward things. But then he adds outward things, anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language. So he lists five things inwardly that we need to deal with, five things outwardly we need to deal with, and then he says we need to clothe ourselves with some good things. Compassion. Kindness. Wouldn't our world be a better place if we had more compassion and kindness? Well, how about humility? Whether your last name is Trump or Clinton, how about humility? Or even gentleness. Gentleness. What a strange word in our world today, gentleness. We almost look at gentleness as if it's weakness, and really it's a sign of strength. And then lastly, he says patience. So he says, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. How many of you could say that that describes your spouse? How many of you could say that that describes you as you look in the mirror? Compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. And then he goes on to spell it out even further and says, bear with each other, forgive one another, forgive as the Lord forgave you. Let peace rule in your hearts. Be thankful for everything. Let God's word dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another, singing psalms and hymns. And then he says, in this blanket sense, Whatever you do, whether in word or in deed, do it all in the name of the Lord. And that is the question. Can we do everything we do in the name of the Lord? It's not so simple, is it? We're easily confused. I remember hearing about a church that needed air conditioning. And by the way, we do have some of those same needs here. We just had our church council meeting, and we were talking about our chillers and our cooling, and sometimes you fan in here. I saw a bunch of you fanning last week because our chillers and things weren't working as they should, and so we had some difficulties. You know how much those things cost? About $100,000 a piece if you buy new ones. We need two. Huh. Well, there are other needs that we have as well, but you're a gracious community of faith, and so everything's going to be fine. But nevertheless, the church that I'm talking about, things were not fine. They had some needs, and they had an air conditioning need in particular. So the pastor stood in front of the congregation and said, I challenge you. The Holy Spirit has led someone here to give a great sum of money for our air conditioning. And whomever gives the most money, you're going to get to pick three hymns. So the pastor passed out the plates, collected the plates, stood behind the altar, and counted the money. I guess he was trying to decide whether or not he needed to pass the plates again or again. But nevertheless, he was shocked and amazed and overcome with joy as he saw a check for $100,000. $100,000. And he said, I don't know who gave it, but I want you to come up. And this older woman came to the front. And she was embarrassed, and he was just overwhelmed with joy. He said, oh, thank you so much. Thank you so much. And now you get to pick your three hymns. And she said, I'll take him. And I'll take him. I'll take him. Oh, if it were just that easy. If it were just that easy. But it's not that easy. These three not so simple rules of doing no harm and doing good and staying in love with God are not that easy. But that's why God has done something for us that is just amazing. God doesn't expect us to keep these rules in our own strength and power, but God gives us the Holy Spirit. Holiness comes because of the Holy Spirit living in our lives. We cannot do these rules. We cannot keep these rules without God's help. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 15, Peter writes, but just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do, for it is written, be holy because I am holy, says the Lord. Well, I don't know about you, but I believe that if God asks us to do something in Scripture, God gives us the power to accomplish it. God would not ask us to do something if he did not give us the power to do it. And so what God says right here is, just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all that you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy, says the Lord. So holiness is a gift from God. It's a sign of the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. In Luke's Gospel, the 11th chapter, it says in Luke 11:11 and verse 13, which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, will give him a snake? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more, listen, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? So the ability, the power, the extraordinary gift of God that comes through our salvation is the gift of the Holy Spirit to live within us and bear fruit from within us so that we end up bearing that fruit that's defined in Galatians chapter 5. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy. And see how this sounds like Colossians chapter 3. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. So God wants us to put on some good things and gives us the power through the Holy Spirit to be able to accomplish it. So all we need to do is we need to exhale sin and we need to inhale the Spirit. We need to say every day, come Holy Spirit, fill me. It's not a one-time thing. It's a continual thing. In the book of Ephesians, in Ephesians chapter 5, it says in verse 15, be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Sound familiar? Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Be filled continually with the Holy Spirit. Speak to one another with psalms and hymns. Sounds like Colossians 3. Speak to one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Be filled continually with the Holy Spirit. So, in these three not-so-simple rules and how we might have God's Spirit dwelling within us, is we might need to exhale sin, inhale the Holy Spirit, and pray every day, Lord, whatever I have done today or left undone today, please forgive me. And please fill me with your Holy Spirit so that I can have the power to fulfill these rules on holy living so that my life might be better. And the world might be better. Colossians 3 is about character clothing. Kindness, love, faithfulness, patience, peace. All these things. I don't know if you know much about emojis. The 902 service, they know a lot more about emojis. But maybe you do know about emojis. These little characters that you can add to a text message or to a Facebook post or to an email that you're sending out. There's even a website called emojimyface.com that I have on my phone that for a small fee you can get your face and as an emoji of sorts. Now, emoji is an interesting thing. It helps accent your cyber messages so that you can express yourself in a way without having to type so many words. You can just put an emoji with a statement or a brief thing, or you can just stick an emoji on that text by itself, and it conveys a message. Emoji is a Japanese word. E in emoji means picture. And moji in Japanese means character. So every emoji is a character picture of a certain attitude, a certain way of life, a certain notion about something. It's a character picture. Well, I dare say if we believe in holiness, that God loves us so much He wants us changed, that we are character pictures of Jesus. We're supposed to be character pictures of Jesus. And this clothing we're to put on in Colossians 3 reminds me of dress codes. And we're not living in a day and age of dress codes, are we? We really aren't. Some of you remember the days, at least I remember the days, when flying on an airplane was such a luxury that you got dressed up to fly. Remember that? And now if you take a flight, people are wearing their pajamas. And you see tattoos that you just don't want to see. And it doesn't just happen on airplanes, but when you go to the grocery store. Our father, my brother sitting right here, our father would be 100 years old this coming Tuesday. August the 2nd, 1960. He had dress codes. Goodness gracious, I don't know if he did this to you. We're quite distant in age. I'm not going to say which one of us is younger. But we're quite distant in age. But when I was around, Daddy, Saturday night was a big deal because you had to polish your shoes because you were going to church. You had to get your clothes out. You had to have a haircut. Many a day, he would say what we often say in Latin, but he wouldn't say it in Latin, vestit faci verum, clothes make the man. But he would say, proper display is half sold. Did he ever tell you that? Yeah. Proper display is half sold. You dress for success. You don't look like a bum. You don't dress like a slob. You clean up. And he would be appalled with this fuzz on my face. I remember the first time I came home from the University of South Carolina. I see you, Joe. When I came home from the University of South Carolina, and he was standing out in the yard, and it was my first trip home, fall semester, off at college, and I grew a mustache. And as soon as he could make out my face, he started. It is what it is. Proper display is half soul. His favorite Bible verse was Matthew chapter 5, verse 16. So let your light shine among men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Holiness. Clothes are all symbolic, but they have real consequences. And we Christians are immigrants to a new country trying to learn how to live in it with a new experience, a new life, and new eyes. And we need to put on faithfulness and gentleness and love and patience and kindness. We need to put them on. We need holiness. Let me close with the story of Hans Christian Andersen. You've all heard this story, but Hans Christian Andersen and his story about the emperor has no clothes reminds me of Colossians chapter 3 and our desire to put our best foot forward and to have holiness in our way of life. He tells a story about a king who had fancy clothes, but he wanted the best, most elaborate, most beautiful clothes imaginable. And so he hired these two people to come in to make him new clothes. And they were crooks and con men and scam artists. And they came in and said, well, king, we'll make you these new clothes. It's going to cost you about half your kingdom. We're going to make you these new clothes. But you need to know this, that only people who are worthy can see these clothes. Anybody who is unfit for service in your kingdom cannot see them. And then they'll think you don't have any clothes on. Anybody who can't see them is ignorant. So we're going to make you these new clothes, and you're going to look just grand. And so he puts on the new clothes. And of course, they're invisible. They're make-believe. And he's standing there in his birthday suit, and he doesn't want to admit that he can't see them because he doesn't want to seem ignorant, and he doesn't want to seem that he's unfit for service in his own kingdom. And so he says, oh, they look great. And then he invites his aides in and his courtiers, and they say, oh, and they don't want to admit, because they know the drill, they don't want to admit that they can't see them, so they say, oh, you look so good, those clothes, those are the most expensive, I mean, goodness, what you had to pay for those. And then he walks along the streets, and everybody, because they know the drill, oh, look at the king's new wardrobe, he looks so grand. And then this little child speaks up and says, Mama, he's not wearing anything. Finally, a little child shall lead them. Colossians chapter 3 is that little child's voice to you and to me. Do I look like a Christian? And it's not just in wardrobe, but do I look like a Christian in thought, word, or deed? Can people tell that Jesus lives in me, that the Holy Spirit has a hold of me. In the name of the Father, and Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.